Well, thank you all for being here on rather late on Friday afternoon. I'm really pleased to see this audience. I'm going to talk today, we talked at the beginning of the conference, we had a panel on migrants. I'm going to talk today on my research on labor migrants' access to social services in Russia. It should more properly be titled, Tajik Labor Migrants' Access to Social Services in Moscow. Okay, so I'm going to start with the quote that just frames my study. Access to healthcare is one of the most pressing of Social Security branches and the protection of rights for undocumented migrants. In most migrants, particularly Central Asian migrants in Russia, are undocumented. Since they are often at higher risk of health problems than regular migrants and nationals, whether due to the conditions in their home country which cause them to move, the experience of their migration, or the unregulated working environments in which they usually end up employed, and that's very often work in construction, on rather dangerous construction sites, and living in very close quarters with other migrants, often as many as 20 living in an apartment, sharing everything. So I want to do an introduction, talk a little bit about push and pull factors of migration, about which most of you already know, and then talk about my research. So the end of the Cold War was a watershed event for international migration, in nowhere more than in the post-Soviet world or post-communist world, where restrictions on migration collapsed with communism and very large transfers of people began. Russia, by the mid-2000s, was a major receiving state with the second largest labor migrant population after the U.S., perhaps equivalent to Germany. In Tajikistan, a small and very quite poor Central Asian state that suffered a bitter civil war during most of the 1990s, is a major contributor of labor to the Russian market and the most remittance-dependent country, peripheral state, in fact, one of the most remittance-dependent states in the world for its GDP. So the study that I set out to do is mostly on Tajik labor migrants in Moscow between the years 2000 and 2015. In order to do this research, I did several rounds of interviews in Moscow in 2012, 13, and 14, in Dushanbe in 2012, and I also had some focus groups with Tajik migrants who had returned from work in Moscow, done by some people from the International Organization for Migration. And these interviews in focus groups, along with other research, are the basis for my talk. So I just thought I should start out by looking at what de jure and rights and de facto access to social services do migrants have, focusing on healthcare. So I think first it's social rights guaranteed by international conventions that Russia has signed, by Russian law. And then secondly, since NGOs have become, since a great deal of attention is now paid to non-governmental organizations as organizations that can substitute for the state and fill gaps in public provision, I also asked whether NGOs function to substitute where the Russian state is missing as a social service provider. I'm going to go very quickly through this. The push factors driving migration are mainly economic. Tajikistan is very poor. It has a poorly developed economy. It has very high levels of poverty, and the war, they led to waves of migration. First, a brain drain in which many professionals left during the 1990s. Leading to what is called brain waste, meaning that many of these people in Moscow worked outside of their professions in much less skilled jobs. And then after 2000, the brawn drain, with much greater numbers of young people, mostly men, high school graduates, with very little knowledge of Russian or other skills. Politically, there's a visa-free regime between the Central Asian states and Russia, so it's easy enough for people to come from Central Asia, and they have a right to come and stay for 90 days, but they do not have a legal right to work. The international financial institutions encourage the Tajik government in a policy of exporting its labor force, arguing that young workers would go to Russia, gain skills, earn money, come back, start businesses, and sort of start up the Tajik economy. I'm sorry to say that that has happened almost not at all. Almost all of the money sent back has gone to living expenses, immediate expenses. And culturally, the two states have a post-colonial shared space, despite their cultural and religious differences. And wages, even the poorest wages in Moscow, are four times those in Tajikistan when people can find employment there. The pull factor is mostly the rapid economic growth in Russia, the Russian decline in the Russian population and labor force because of low birth rates and high middle-aged male mentality. So the migrant labor force was filling a gap left by a shrinking domestic labor force with an estimated 8 to 10% of total employments migrants, not all of them Tajik migrants, but several million of those. So I hope you can see this. I have just a couple of charts here. This one showing facets of Russia's population decline, where the green or the dark lines are natural increase and the white lines are migration. And you can see that migration, the migration in the early 90s is not labor migration for the most part, but that after 2000 is, and you can see that that started and has been largely sustained. And this study that projects the dynamics of Russia's working age and total population in the absence of migration through 2026. So we see that labor migration is likely to, as will almost inevitably remain a large-scale phenomenon in the Russian economy, whatever else happens. So what developed between these two states was a kind of political economy of exchange. So instead of the semi-colonial status in Tajikistan in the Soviet period, Moscow is a global city, absorbed large amounts of low-skilled service and construction workers in its highly stratified labor market. Tajikistan on the periphery and a structured relationship of inequality between those two states is developed. Tajikistan has had a remittance-driven growth of its GDP in the absence of significant domestic economic development. Here I show you a chart on remittance inflows from Russia to Tajikistan, beginning nearly around 2005 and then increasing to almost half of Tajikistan's GDP. And then we see here remittances as a percent of GDP and how much they've declined after the beginning of the Russian recession. 212 is the highest year. In 213 and 14, remittances have declined dramatically, illustrating the dependence of the Tajik national economy on Russian on labor migration. So, social rights. I looked at migrants de jure social rights. Russia is has signed the Convention on Protection of Rights of Migrants and Their Families, which provide a universal right to emergency medical care. And this on this promise, the Russian government and the Russian medical establishment on the whole delivers. People who have emergencies, serious injuries, accidents, in Thailand, is also treated as an emergency, are provided with care. Russia's also signed the International Convention on the Rights of the Child, which says that every child on a given territory has a right to be educated. And on the whole, as far as I'm able to determine, the relatively limited number of migrant children does in fact attend school in Russia. Russia is also a party to World Health Organization protocols on treatment of tuberculosis and other infectious diseases. There, the government hasn't performed as well. Most Tajik workers, at least who become infected with tuberculosis, should be treated in Russia legally, but on the whole, they go home instead. ILO Convention on Migrant Social Security Rights, this Russia has not signed. So migrants have no rights to social insurance, pensions, medical insurance, any kind of social insurance. In terms of Russian legislation, until 2011, about 30% of the Tajik migrants who were legally registered, and they were the most likely to bring their families, were covered by insurance, which provided preschool, prenatal, and infant care. After insurance reform in 2011, most of those workers lost their coverage, and again, the only non-emergency medical care available to most migrants was care for which they paid. De facto rights, based on interviews and focus groups, as I said, emergency care, including childbirth, is generally provided. Even without a passport, if there's a real emergency, they'll take care of you. You have to pay for other treatments. If somebody is injured and can't work any longer, the injured person is generally sent home. For infectious diseases, treatment is often not provided. If a migrant has TB, legally it has to be treated in Russia, but it's expensive. No one wants to deal with it, so it's involved in an it's resolved in an informal manner. He goes home. Representatives of international health organizations whom I interviewed in Dushanbe were very critical of Russian authorities for their failure or refusal to follow international protocols, particularly on treatment of tuberculosis. This was confirmed by focus group participants who returned to Tajikistan infected with tuberculosis. Even for the types of medical care that are guaranteed, there are complications of access. So childbirth is treated, but prenatal treatment has to be paid for, and women who come to hospitals without certificates can be refused treatment at local hospitals. Children have the right to go to school, but they need health certificates, inoculations, and insurance to enter and attend school, and those generally cost money, although most of migrant parents seem to find the money to insure and take care of their children. So, since the state doesn't provide very much, many of these workers are poor, what about non-governmental organizations? Do they serve as alternative providers? There's a lot of attention now to non-governmental organizations in public health as organizations that can substitute for or fill gaps left by states in health, education, and other areas. In 2012, I interviewed the representatives of all the non-governmental organizations identified as working with migrants on social issues that I could find in Moscow using a kind of snowball technique going from one to the other. And I did follow-up interviews with several of them in 2013 or 2015. I found that there were none that directly provided health services to migrants, partly because they didn't have the resources, and partly because even when they did, licensing was difficult and regulations were complicated. So there was one international health organization that did deliver medical care in other countries and wanted to do so in Russia, but simply could not get a license, could not meet all the regulations to run even clinics to help people. A few of the NGOs that I studied connected migrants with willing providers, often doctors or other medical professionals from Central Asia or linked to it. These organizations also advocated for and sometimes subsidized care and provided legal advocacy for workers who had been hurt in accidents. The largest and most active of these organizations, which had its own very adequate funding, I was told by one of its representatives, we have small projects to help migrants with access. Most of our projects are implemented by volunteers. Our hotline connects migrants to specialists if there's one in the network. In sum, I concluded that these non-governmental organizations, though very well-intentioned and doing, I think, the best they can do, on the whole, very little. They have contingent funding that's limited and temporary. They cobbled together fragile networks of providers. The first time I did interviews, three of these NGOs had collaborated to form a network of doctors and other medical providers that were willing to serve migrants. And by the time of my later interviews, that network had largely collapsed and those organizations were no longer working together. So NGOs are few to begin with, have limited resources, are hobbled by regulations and can do little to fill gaps in public services. At least three of the 10 or 12 that I interviewed had closed between 2010 and 2015, either because their grants ran out or, in the case of the International Health Organization, because it couldn't function in Russia, it couldn't get licenses. Okay. So what about formal private services? There are not a lot, there are lots of private medical services in Russia, in Moscow, most, in fact, they're concentrated there. But most of them are quite expensive, and they're facilities that are used by upper income people, people in the top income quintile. I should also have said that when medical care is provided, there are often issues of cultural sensitivity, particularly for women, and questions about whether medical providers are going to challenge the legal status of migrants. There are some formal private services emerging. The one that I've learned the most about was a clinic called Maya, run by members of the Kyrgyz diaspora. Kyrgyzstan is another Central Asian state, of course. The Kyrgyz diaspora is somewhat better established than the others from Central Asia. It has more professionals and others with resources. It is open some clinics that offer a broad range of reasonably paid medical services with culturally sensitive treatments that advertise to migrants. There's an understanding that no questions will be asked about registration status. But even the best facility in this network does not meet the standards for full-fledged hospital accreditation in Moscow. The standards for accreditation came up again and again. This is a rather badly put into the framework, but this is a part of the advertising from a brochure that's distributed by that clinic. It says our doctors are from Tashkent, Dushanbe, and Bishkek. It lists all the specialties and it promises migrants that there will be doctors who speak their languages, which is important for Tajiks because they speak a Persian language that's different from the languages of all the other Central Asians. And that it's welcoming to migrants that they can go without fear and with the understanding that their cultural norms will be respected. I already did that. But there seem to be very few in the way of private clinics of this sort that are available to migrants. Migrants can get paid care in public clinics. Again, that raises the issues that I've already mentioned. Informal services. Despite this very limited access to medical care, migrants need all kinds of certificates of health checks and other documents for employment, for their children, for other checks. They often turn to informal and shadow services in order to get these documents. Document services that provide medical and other documents are advertised at bus stop shelters all over Moscow, even in upscale districts. Some of these documents are literally fakes. There's no effort to do any kind of medical testing. Others are run by well-connected people who can buy allocated numbers of real documents with stamps that are recognized by the government and then sell these to migrants. Usually, the purchase or acquisition of these medical certificates is done without any medical tests actually having been carried out, which makes them rather useless. Diaspora communities, I didn't look at this issue as systematically, but it is commonly claimed that the ethnic communities in Moscow help each other. The Tajik community is united. If an accident happens or a migrant becomes ill, relatives will help if they are there. If someone is sick or dies, people from the village pool funds. This may be true, but in this migration, most people work, men and women. Tajiks do not live in an enclave in Moscow. Many live on construction sites. The rest tend to live spread out at the very edges of the city, where both housing is cheap and police surveillance is lighter than it is in the center. Focus group members, participants talk about help from family members, but really not from a broader community. I'm not saying that that community isn't there and doesn't do its best, but in terms of someone who has a serious injury or long-term illness, it just seemed to me that the community doesn't have the resources to deal with that, and the people just go home. Every year, about 11% of migrants who return home report that they do so for health reasons or medical reasons. I want to make it clear that with this presentation, I am not trying to say or suggest that migrants are sicker than other people or are vectors of infectious diseases. In fact, sociologist Cynthia Buckley, who studied this topic for a long time, shows that for Russia and many other cases, there is what she calls a healthy migrant effect, that is evidence that most of those who come are healthier than the population of the receiving state because they're younger, because they're able-bodied, because they have the resources to travel, and in the case of Tajiks and Russians, because the Tajiks tend not to smoke and drink, at least not much. There is an absence of reliable data on the health status of in-migrants or the health effects of migrant status. I tried talking to people in Tajikistan about this issue. Most of the health authorities with whom I spoke there were convinced that migrants came back with a lot of health, that many migrants came back with health problems. But Tajik medical health data is not organized in a way that would allow them to sort out migrants. And studies done by various organizations actually produce inconsistent results. What is clear is that the medical needs are greater as the numbers of women and children increase. So my conclusion is, migrants live precariously in Russia with few social or legal rights, not only in terms of access to medical care, but in terms of access to legal help, any kind of labor rights, employment rights, wage rights. The government complies with its international commitments to emergency medical care and education, but it doesn't offer almost any other services to migrants. There is a small network of international organizations and non-governmental organizations that provide help and advocacy, but its capacity is very limited. And there is a growth of marginalized populations in a shadow economy that undermines human security and welfare provision in Russia. I just want to say, since I think I have 2 minutes, one more thing. It seems to me, and this is a direct result of the study, but just an implication that I draw from it, it seems to me that the presence of large numbers of migrant workers who are irregular in status, who are not registered, who don't have legal residence permits and so forth, it seems that all of this is ambiguous for the Russian welfare state. On the one hand, it puts in the middle of major cities as well as in other places a large marginalized population that's really closed out of the welfare state and that have much less security and welfare than the rest of the population and yet constitute perhaps 8 to 10% of the labor force. This is also a very inexpensive labor force, relatively speaking. On the other hand, though, the Tajiks and others constitute a kind of disposable labor force. That is, when there's a downturn in the economy, they can easily be dismissed from their jobs. Regulations can be enforced more so that larger numbers are sent home, or they leave because they no longer have employment. They have no rights to any kind of social compensation. They're very vulnerable to both legal and economic pressures in Russian society. And I think, looking in a sort of hard-hearted way at this phenomenon, that it means that there's a part of the labor force with which the Russian government can dispose when it no longer needs them, with very little cost and virtually no obligations. I think that's true in the United States, too. This is just a picture that was taken of some of the women migrants in Narabat, Tajikistan, who were part of one of the focus groups.